Understand, just because the music is at a height and it's fast and it's fun and it's exciting doesn't mean that when the music goes down that the praise gets any less.
Right.
Hallelujah. In Isaiah 61, it says, and this is what this next song is about, the Spirit of the Lord God is upon me because the Lord hath anointed me to preach the good things to the meek. Lord, that's what changes people. That's what changes people is the good news. There's people all around us who are depressed and down and in despair, but it's that good news that lifts them up. Whether they realize it or not, their spirits are lifted.
Yes, praise God.
And he has sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives, and the opening of the prison to them that are bound. It's not, hey, would you please let them go? Can we make a deal? Can we trade this for that? No, it's proclaiming, let them go.
Yes, amen.
Break the
Hallelujah.
Chains. Yes. Set them free. Yes. That's what the Lord wants. He wants us to go in boldness, and he wants us to proclaim who he is.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Yes.
To proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord. This year, double for our trouble. Am I right?
Yes.
Later in this section right here, I think it's verse 7, it says, for your shame, you shall have double.
Praise God.
And that's not just money. That's double the blessings in every way. You know, even after 2 months of dealing with leg pain, God healed me.
Yes. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Praise God.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord, for letting me stand up here.
Yes.
Yes.
Thank you, Jesus. So to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord and the day of vengeance of our God. Vengeance is his. So no matter what goes on around us, what we think is happening, what we think we need to make right, he's making right.
Amen.
He's dealing with it. Hallelujah. And to comfort all those who mourn.
Yes.
He turns that mourning into dancing, am I right?
That's right.
Hallelujah. Amen. So let's praise him again and continue what we're doing here. Hallelujah, Jesus. Thank you.
Preach good news.
back to a verse that we sang just a minute ago. This is the year, this is the day. He will comfort all who mourn. He will provide for those who grieve in Zion. He's pouring out his oil of gladness. Instead of mourning, we will praise our God. This is the year. This is the day.
Thank you. this is a moment in time that you've got a place in time that God has called us. Send that rain. I hear the Lord saying He is sending the rain. He sent that rain through His church. When He sent Jesus and Jesus commissioned us, that rain God is sending is you. We are the rain that God is sending to the people, to His people. God sends the rain on the just and He sends it on the unjust. He has sent Jesus. He has sent forgiveness to the just and to the unjust. And we're here to proclaim today that we are rising up as a church, as the body of Christ, to not stand back, but to go forward. To see His hand, God's mighty hand. The vengeance of the Lord is the justice of the Lord. And that justice is called Jesus. And it's called forgiveness. God is not out to kill us. God is out to save us. Hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah to the King of Kings. If you need salvation right now, come get it. Come get it. Because He's not coming. He's not going to make you come. You got to come. But He came so you could come. Hallelujah. I serve a risen Savior. Don't let the devil keep you from the blessings of God. Because they're from everlasting to everlasting. He's a risen Savior. Woo, glory, He's my God. Whoa, I'm going to see His goodness in the land of the living. Woo, glory. Glory, hallelujah. He's a loving Jesus. He's not a quiet Jesus, but He spent quiet times with the Father. But He's not a quiet Jesus. He's a saving Jesus. He's a healing Jesus. He's a loving Jesus. And if you need what He has, He said, come. All that are thirsty, let them come. Come to those living waters. And He said, you'll never thirst. In this world, you're going to be thirsty. But if you come to Him, you'll never thirst. But you'll have a well of water that's on the inside of you. They'll spring up when you need to be sprung up. The devil is not who he makes himself out to be. He's a loser. And he lost 2,000 years ago. And I'm here to proclaim the victory. And I'm not just proclaiming it alone. I've got people in this church to believe it. And we're going to see it in Concord and the world. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Praise His name this morning. I don't need a mic. I just need Jesus. He is the mic. He is the Word. He is God. And He is love. Amen. And He loves you. He loves you. Hallelujah. He loves you. Woo, glory. Hallelujah. God is good. He loves us unconditionally. Oh, glory. Sometimes you might just need to, I don't know. You just got to do what you got to do to praise God. I got to praise Him. Not for what He's done, but what He's doing. I said, He's done a great things in my life, but He's just getting started. He's done a great things in Pastor Jack's life, but He's just getting started. I love to ride motorcycles. Sometimes I used to have one. You have to have a kickstart to get that thing started. They got ones you push a button now. You don't have to kickstart Jesus. He's already on. All you got to do is get on and ride the road of salvation. Ride with Jesus. It ain't no bumpy ride, but it is a joyful ride. Amen. Jesus don't want you in the valley. He wants you on the mountaintop. So you can see your enemy. You don't have to walk in that valley because He walked it for you. I'm not saying there's not valleys out there, but you determine if you walk in it. We don't go to the valley of shadow of death. Jesus said, I'm walking you through it. Get out of it. Amen. There is no darkness in heaven. Why should it be in our lives? Why should it be in our lives? If we keep ourselves in Christ, He keeps the evil one from touching us. So if the evil's touching you, it's not God. We haven't kept ourselves in Him. But just because that's coming doesn't mean you're not saved. We just need to get back in Him. In Him. Because in Him is joy. Everlasting joy shall be on their heads. Hallelujah. Amen. Glory to God. You can be seated. I mean, I hate to keep you standing, but I'm sorry. If you're sitting and we standing, that's fine. Praise team. Thank you. Hallelujah. I needed that. Don't think pastors, apostles, preachers, and teachers don't need to be ministered to. We need you. The church needs you. The pastors need you. The world needs us. We're not here in competition, pastors. We're here to compliment one another. I miss my pastors this week. Man, Jesus misses us. He misses us. And he's coming back for us. Amen. There's never going to be another time that we're going to be separated again other than this life right now. But you don't, and it's not the separation in the spirit, it's the flesh. We're going to see Christ, we're going to see God in the flesh, in the face of Jesus Christ. And we can see him today as he saw his Father in the flesh. High and lifted up. Glory to God. I'm on a high. It's called the Most High this morning. And it's not because of this flesh, it's because of the Spirit of God that will cause you in your sorrow to have joy. Why? Because Jesus took your sorrow. He took your griefs. He took your pain. I said he took your pain. Give it to him. Rejoice, because the devil don't like to see you rejoice in pain. Why? It enforces the victory that we have in Christ Jesus. I'm not a pretender. I'm a contender for the faith. That means I get in the ring and I fight. And I got a coach. His name is Jesus. And he knows the weakness of our enemies. And it's not people, it's the devil that uses people. Your enemy is not in flesh and blood. Your enemy is the devil. And he's a spirit being. He is not a created being of his own. God created him good. He decided to be evil. Amen. And we're here to pronounce Jesus is good. He is so good. And Jack, you take all the time you need. And if you get hungry, Bojangles is right around the corner, but come back. Because Bojangles ain't got nothing that Jesus has. If it wasn't for Jesus, there'd be no Bo. Come on. Bo knows Bojangles, but Bo knows Jesus. Because chicken's good. Amen. I got my Bible. It's in my pocket. Praise God. But keep your word in the heart. One day they might turn this off from you. But they can't take the word out of your heart. But the devil will try to steal it. But you got to give it to him. Because it ain't his to take. He's not the creator. He's a created being that failed. And he is fallen. That proves it. He's under my feet. He's under my feet. Glory to God. Hallelujah. We're getting ready to give this morning. Amen. It ain't about your money, but we're going to receive an offering. Because it's about, do you love Jesus? And we're here to proclaim. We're here to do a work. And I just feel like we're just getting started. But you know what? Time is short. We are in the end of the end times. Before the Lord raptures his church out, and great, great tribulation is going to hit this earth. But until then, we're building his kingdom, one soul at a time. And Father, we just thank you today that we can do that together. As you give this morning, I want to encourage you. I was pricked in my heart. Does anybody in this church remember O.D. Christ? Dr. Gary Price was our former pastor here. O.D. Christ, he had on the Message of Victory a couple of programs here, but I've talked to her since then. She went to Life Christian University. She's a Jewish lady that went through World War II in Germany and married an American husband, American man, came here, and I'll read her profile, maybe not today, but she sent me an email that she is for. Let me pull it up here. I want to make sure I tell you the right. I'm just still caught up in his presence. Hallelujah. Come on. Ooh, glory. Thank you, Jesus. Let's see. What did I have it on, Lord? It was an open app. O.D. Christ, she sent me an email because she knows me personally. I helped get some DVDs multiplied that she did. I watched them that she sat down. That program, she sat down upstairs with Dr. Price. She couldn't get nobody to get some copies made, but God sent me. We got it done, Terry. So I sent her about 20 copies, and she was so thankful. But she let me know that she is also involved in the Cabarrus Women's Center here in Concord. Now, we had a victory with Roe versus Wade. We had a victory on July the 7th. We declared our independence as a nation, but it took a while for us to be free. See, we declared something, but then that's when the battle started. See, Roe versus Wade, we got declared, we got the victory, but now the battle starts. Now we got to help the women that need our help, that we've already been helping. And that's what she's doing. Cabarrus Christian Center is to help those that, if they get pregnant, they got a choice, that we'll help you through this choice to have the child. That's called life. So we got the victory, but now it comes down to the individual states. And Jody's a part here, and she believes in Cabarrus Christian Center. Now we need to believe what we've been praying for and act. Now when the battle starts, help the women. If God's for you, show them where God's for you. And that's what this place does. So as you give this morning, if you want to give to Pastor Jack, we bless our ministers. But if you want to give, write on the envelope, Pastor Jack. But if you want to give to Odie Christ, as Chris, C-R-I-S-T, that's Odie. Thank you, Colette. Odie, that's Odie. I'm thinking of, never mind. Odie Christ, because she's got a good work that God's called her to do. And one of those other works was she heard that in our high schools, and this was years ago, she'd been in the ministry, in our high schools, that kids had the option to opt out of history. And she was like, our kids need to know our history, the history that she went through. She went through hell. She went through like what Hitler was going through, and she got out of that. She got free. America is a land of the free. And there's other people. Jesus made us free. America's only free because of Christ. And to keep it free, we got to keep Christ in America. Not just on our money, in Cabarrus County, in Mooresville. That's where I live. On your street, to your neighbors. Christ in you, you're bringing hope to America. Not the ungodly. They need our hope. That's why he sent us. That's why he sent Odie Christ. So if you want to give to her this morning, we'll give you two Sundays opportunity, but I've already got it in my heart that she reached out. She didn't reach out to me specifically, but she knows me in our church. So I want to reach out and let her know, we got a gift. How can we give? Because she is there. She's going to be hosting. So there's a table. There's an event coming up. We got an opportunity to show Christ in Cabarrus County. You got an opportunity. So as you give, that's an opportunity. You got a purpose. There's a purpose. If you want a purpose in your heart to give, write that out. Your tithes and offerings, first of all, honor God. And when you honor God, God honors you. When you bless God in your finances, God blesses your finances. When you bless God with loving people, God sends people to love you. Every seed produces after its kind. For God so loved the world, he gave us Jesus. And he turned me into a giver. So when the church, when I started going to a church, when they passed the plate, or when we come up front here at Word of Faith Worship Center, I wanted to love God, and I gave. See, don't give out of a need. I'm just showing you some needs that need to be met. But you give because God gave you Jesus. And we give back because we love God. And that shows our heart is for him. And then he blesses you back 30, 60, 100 fold. Believe for the 100. But you also, if you're believing for that high part, believe for the persecutions too. You don't have to believe for them. They're coming. That's right, Tammy. They're coming. They're attached to it because people don't like you to see people give because they love people. But I'm not here to please people. I'm here to please God. And if you please God, you will please people. Amen. It's like I said, God sends his rain on the just and the unjust, but some have got their umbrella up. He showed me this sitting in this pew. Some's got their umbrella up. I want to do it my way, God. I want to do it my way. But you know what he showed me? All umbrellas, those little drops will come down and hit you on the head. They'll hit you on the head, Tammy. And it only took one drop of the blood of Jesus to save my life from hell. That's right. So even though the devil might think, he sees some of them's got their umbrellas up, but there's a couple drips getting through. And see, all God needs is a drip. All he needs is a drip. And then you'll turn the you'll close the umbrella, and he'll shower you with his blessings. He'll shower you, Jack. I guarantee it. I put my life on it. Amen. I'm going to see it. I'm going to see it. Let's stand. As you get ready to give this morning, know this, you can't outgive my God. Why? He's an awesome God. He's awesome. And this year is a double. And if you're in this church, you might not have heard that, but you're hearing it now. When you give, it ain't just all about your money, but believe for your money. Double for your trouble for 2020 and 2021. We're in 2022, and that's the double. That's what I heard for this church. Amen. And you can take it to the bank if you'll believe it. I said, if you'll believe it, you will have it. Amen. So, Father, we thank you for the day. This is your day, God, and it's a day of victory. There's victory where the Spirit of the Lord is, the Spirit of God is in this place, and there's victory. All you got to do is step into the flow. Pick up your anchor and get aboard for Jesus. That sin will hold you down like an anchor. But I'm telling you, Jesus broke the chain. But he will not pull your anchor. You've got to let it go. And if you'll let go and give it to God, he'll set you on a course that you could never imagined. But God says he will. I will, says the Lord. If you'll just simply obey. Obey what this preacher said today. And obey what the rest of the word you're going to hear today. And if you'll simply obey, God will get in your way. And he'll show you his way. It's the best way. And it's the right way. In Jesus' name. Bring your tithes and offerings to the front. Just worship the Lord. And know that you are blessed.
Should be able to sing for his love forever, because his love is forever. I need to ask people, seeing she's fans, is everyone comfortable here? I'm hot. and she's hot. Okay. Praise God. We're working on it. Hallelujah. I've got a message to sing this morning, which all of us as believers already know. It's about Jesus coming again. Thank you, Lord. Like a babe today in a manger far away,
or a man walking somewhere on a lonely Galilean shore.
A man hanging and dying on that old rugged tree. He's living in royalty. Look up, there's a king on the way.
There's a king on the way. He may be arriving today. We've heard about his coming for so long.
Coming on a cloud, they said, and the sound's gonna raise him dead. And I believe every promise, I know that he's coming again. Just a few fine moments, another tear, another sign. You're ready to leave today, look up, there's a king on the way.
There's a king on the way, he may be arriving today. We've heard about his coming for so long.
Look here, the next verse I have for you this morning. Then shall the king say, oh my gosh, did y'all not? We just sang about it, but he's got something to say. Come on. Then shall the king say, say it, Jesus. On them on his right hand, come ye blessed to my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundations of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me meat. I was thirsty, and you gave me drink. I was a stranger, and you took me in. Naked, and you clothed me. I was sick, and you came to me. I was in prison, Jack, and you've been there, hadn't you? I was in prison, and he went there. When saw me a stranger and took me in, or naked, and you clothed me? Or when saw me sick or prison, and you came unto me? And the king shall answer, saying to them, verily I say unto you, insomuch as you've done it to the least of these, Jesus said, you've done it to me. As you gave this morning, you gave to the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. You did it to Jesus. And everything we do at this church, we do it for Jesus. And that's the King of Kings. It don't get no higher than that. We serve a risen Savior, the King of Kings, and he takes what you gave today and he presents it to Father God, Terry. He says, look what my church at Concord did. Look, Father, look what they gave today. Look, but he's not showing them the money. See, because the money is just what we do. He shows them, look at Samantha, Lord. Look what I'm doing with Samantha, Lord. Look, Father, look what we're going to do with Samantha. Look what we're doing with Jared. See, that's what Jesus presents to the Father. He shows the Father what I'm doing. and say, that's personal to you. That's what he's doing for you, because that's what you did for him. You gave into his kingdom. Now he's going to raise up your family. That's God. See, he gives us the desires of our hearts, which are his desires. And his desires is that none perish, but all come into the saving knowledge of the truth. Amen. That's what you gave in today. And that is what Jesus will make sure. Now, everybody's got a free will. God will not override it, but Jesus is right there waiting. And all of heaven, all that rain that we prayed about this morning is ready to be poured out when that one sinner says, repents and says, Lord, you were right. I was wrong. Jesus, now he says, come in, my child. Come in, my child. Look at all the Father and I have for you. Not up there, down here. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. My God, we're on the earth. This is the hell, the biggest hell a Christian's ever going to see is right now, because our best is yet to come. Amen. But we can have joy in the midst of sorrow. Right. Amen. Hallelujah. Pastor Jack, let's just agree. We have a confession that we use to confess over our offering, but Pastor Reed, come here. We're not going to confess that this morning. We're just going to say what God says. And the confession we have is good, because it came from the Word of God. Let's hold these up, Pastor Reed. Father, there's names right here. You don't have to publicly confess it right now, but God knows the hearts. Name what you want God to do for you, for your family, for your children's children, for your granddad, for the world. Name it and watch him do it. Because when you give out of the abundance of your heart, your mouth will speak. Speak it and watch God do it. I said, speak it. Now, he's not going to hurt them. He's going to save them. Amen. Because sin is what hurts them. The devil is what's hurting them. But God said, you pray for them. When you give, I'm going to save them. I'm going to heal them. I'm going to deliver them. I'm going to protect them. I'm going to forgive them. Because the last words Jesus said is, Father, forgive them. That's the vengeance that's coming, is forgiveness. Amen. They can let it pass, but Jesus, he'll come back. He'll keep coming until a certain time. Don't wait. Today is the day of salvation. Father, we thank you today as these tithes and offerings came in that you're coming in, Lord. You're coming in. You're coming in. When they ask, you're there. So, Father, we thank you, Lord, for your mighty work and power that's going to be displayed, that's manifesting in this church this morning. And every time where your presence is, there's power. There's power in your name. In the name of Jesus, we speak blessings over every gift that came in today, Lord. And we speak deliverance and salvation to all those that they represent today in this place, Lord. Have your way. God, bring it. Bring it, Lord. And we'll thank you. We'll give you the praise now. Bring your glory, Lord. Bring your glory to them, Father, in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. So this time I'm going to ask Pastor Jack and our kids. We've got children's church. They might already been dismissed, but they're usually dismissed right after praise and worship. But we kind of got a little excited today, and we want our kids to experience the excitement of God. Every church is a little different. You got to have basic foundations, but as God purposes in our heart, there's been a great thing that God set up here, and I haven't changed a lot. I'm just kind of going with what it is. As God leads us, we have little changes. That's okay, because I'm different than Dr. Price, but I'm not different than Jesus. The love has got to be the same, and that's never going to change. So Jack's going to show us the love of Christ through Jack's life, through his testimony. He's good. Amen. He's better than good. God says you better than good. So stand on your feet. Give this man a hand clap. He's been preparing for this.
Jerry's got it. Thank you.
Just one more thing. Maybe some of you wasn't here last Sunday, but Jack was here, and he didn't kind of get the memo. We've got some Word of Faith worship shirts that we have, and sometimes we'll get a little note that, you know, if you want to wear your shirt. Well, Jack came in, and he was dressed out. And he's like, somebody didn't get me the memo. So today he's dressed down.
Okay.
Wednesday night was leaving Bible study, and I said, oh, Sunday will be casual Sunday. Where are your shorts? Where are your flip-flops? I come in here with a suit and tie on. Lord, Vic and Colette, you dressed down it. I went and took the tie off, took the coat off, it's in the car. Now I'm in here and I'm sweating. I should have wore shorts. I'd like to thank y'all for this blessing to come together and speak today. I'm thankful to see part of my family here. And when you talked about the motorcycle, I thought you were looking at my brother. No, no, he's lazy. He's got the button. He's lazy.
He knows what I'm talking about.
Yeah. I'd like to say, first of all, I thank God for this blessing. And it seemed like everything the pastor was talking. Now, how am I supposed to follow what he did?
You're following Jesus.
I'm following Jesus. That's right. But everything that was spoken about, sung about, is around this word that God laid upon me. I'm going to be reading out of Luke 15. From 11 through 31, the parable of the lost son. Everyone knows that knows me, and those out there that may not know me, this is so much about me. This is my life in a nutshell. The Father's word. Jesus continued, there was a man who had two sons. The younger one said to his father, Father, give me my share of the estate. So he divided his property between them. Not long after that, the youngest son got together all he had, set off for a distant country, and there squandered his wealth in wild living. After he had spent everything, there was severe famine in the whole country, and he began to have need. So he went and hired himself out to a citizen of that country who sent him to his fields to feed pigs. He longed to fill his stomach with the pods that the pigs were eating, but no one gave him anything. When he came to his senses, he said, how many of my father's hired men have food to spare? And here I am starving to death. I will set out and go back to my father and say to him, Father, I have sinned against you, against heaven and against you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me like one of your hired men. So he got up and went to his father. But while he was still a long way off, his father saw him and was filled with compassion for him. He ran to his son, threw his arms around him, and kissed him. The son said, Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I'm no longer worthy to be called your son. But the father said to his servants, Quick, bring the best robe and put it on him. Put a ring on his fingers and sandals on his feet. Bring the fattened calf and kill it. Let's have a feast and celebrate. For this son of mine was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found. So they began to celebrate. Meanwhile, the older son was in the field. When he came near the house, he heard music and dancing. So he called one of the servants and asked him, what was going on? Your brother has come, he replied, and your father has killed the fattened calf because he has him back safe and sound. The older brother became angry and refused to go in. So his father went out and pleaded with him. But he answered his father, Look, all these years I've been slaving for you and never disobeyed your orders, yet you never gave me a young goat so I could celebrate with my friends. But when this son of yours, who squandered your property with prostitutes, comes home, you kill the fattened calf for him. My son, the father said, you're always with me, and everything I have is yours. But we had to celebrate and be glad, because this brother of yours was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found. Again, this parable has so many different levels. You can teach on this several Sundays, probably a month or so. But today I would like to talk about the parable. Some people like to think that today the Bible doesn't pertain to them. Well, as I said, let's see if this makes anyone think that that could be me. So put yourself in the shoes of the son. Now, in verse 12, it doesn't tell us much about the son. This we can surmise from the verse. We can assume he was from a wealthy family. It says the father had property to divide between the brothers. And being said to be the youngest, I don't know, 14, 16, maybe. When we're young, I know, I speak for myself. I don't know about any of y'all, except for that blonde right there. I know every day of her life. I can teach on my life. And when I accepted Jesus as my Lord and Savior as a young man, like this young man did, I was on fire. I did everything that I was supposed to do until I got of age. Mama said in her household, until you turned 16, you'd be in the house of worship whenever that door was open. I mean, it didn't matter. But as soon as I was able, I got out. You know where it says, not long after that, the younger son got together all he had and set off for a distant country. Then there he squandered his wealth in wild living. I don't know how long he waited. Like I said, I waited until I was 16 and I got out. And I did not remember anything my mother told me. Now, I tried. Well, no, I didn't try. I didn't. I'd go to church when Mama would tell us to. Be a funeral, I'd go to church. You know, just I'd go whenever I had to. And I tried not to have to that many times. But, you know, it's talking about this young man. You know, he told his father. He went and said, I want, I demand. Well, that's not the way it really works. It said, in most cases, he would have to receive his father's at his death, although the father sometimes could choose to divide the inheritance. What is unusual here is that the younger one initiated this division of the estate. This showed arrogance to his father, for he did not want to do what his father told him. Same way with me. My father died when I was like four, so I don't know him. I disobeyed my mother by not pleasing her. And it didn't take much to please Mom, except clean your room and make sure you're at church. And there comes a time when I had to realize what I was doing was wrong, but now I kept on doing it. Not sure just what I was doing, but why I was doing it. You know, it says, after he spent everything, there was a famine in the whole country, and he began to be in need. When my late wife came to her senses and kicked me out of the house, that was the smartest woman I'd ever known. I wasn't worth to be a husband. She told me later on in life, all I had to do was come back and say, I'm sorry. I'd take you back. Remember that. Just saying, I'm sorry, and taking me back. Ah! He said, so he went and hired himself out into a citizen of that country. He sent him to feed the pigs. One of the filthiest jobs you could think of. Even today, it is a filthy job to feed pigs. And being Jewish, pig was unclean. You weren't supposed to touch it, come near it. I'm surprised they had him in the village. But that's how much he lowered himself. Now, I didn't lower myself into feeding pigs. But I did things I'm not proud of. I did things that got me arrested, got me sent to prison. Did I learn? No. I didn't learn after all that. Says, when he came to his senses, he said, how many of my father's hired men have food to spare? And here I am starving to death. I will set out and go back to him, to my father, and say to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me like one of your hired men. The younger son, like many who are rebellious and immature, wanted to be free to live as he pleased. And he had hit bottom before he came to his senses. It often takes great sorrow and tragedy to cause people to look at the only way. Are you trying to live life your own way? Selfishly pushing aside any responsibility, any commitment that gets in your way? Stop and look before you hit bottom. You'll save yourself a lot of trouble. Now, I hit bottom going to prison. But the night that I hit rock bottom was that night when I was in my room by myself for a change. My grandson's heard some of this. I was, doing cocaine, crack, done $400 with crack cocaine, never got high. I heard a voice. And it says, I'll show you what you seek. Now, you're talking about hitting rock bottom. You've been in your room. Like I said, a lot of y'all have heard this. But you go to your room and it's nice and dark, your prayer closet. That's what, there was a void, an emptiness. One, I found out what that felt like. I can't imagine what Jesus felt, but that emptiness, that void, that vacuum that sucked out the life, which was Satan. Jesus said, I'm here. I cried out, Jesus. And he received me back home. So it says, he got up and went to his father. It says, the father watched and waited. He was dealing with a human being with his own will. But he was ready to greet his son if he returned the same way. God's love is constant and patient and welcoming. In the same way, he will search for us and give us opportunities to respond. But he will not force us to come to him. That's what God did for me that night. He said, and I had to accept him. Now, did Satan come after me? Of course he did. I was one of his best people. I helped sell crack. I was, like the story says, around prostitutes, thieves. I had the law called on my house so many times. They called my landlord and said they were going to condemn the property as nuisance to get me out of there. That's bad when your neighbors want you out that bad. Well, I'll tell you later on what happened with that. But while he was still a long way off, his father saw him. Aren't you glad that Jesus is always watching and waiting? He's down there going like, He's like a cheerleader on the sideline in life, watching us. And God, those of us who are on fire and we're just going, he's cheering us on. But then those of us who have stumbled, who have made mistakes, he's saying like, come on, get up. Come on, just take one step in the right way. He's not asking you to run the whole gauntlet. He's wanting you to take one step. Because, if you take one step, what comes after that? Another one. When we watched our children learn how to walk, they took one step at a time. That's all he's asking, for us to take one step. So I said, he came home, he came to his father, like we have. The majority of people in here, I can say confidently, know Jesus. And so... He was waiting, and he came that hug. There was a gentleman when I used to work at Troutman's Barbecue. His name, we called him Petrie. I'm a hugger. Everybody knows that. I'm a hugger. Pete, shake your hand. And he asked me one day, this was way before Corona. He said, Jack, he said, why you got to hug everybody? I said, well, Petrie, I said, aren't you a child of God? Yeah, but I ain't got to hug you. I said, Pete, let me ask you something. When you get to heaven, I said, and I know you will. I said, when Jesus comes up to you, are you going to stick that hand out there and say, how you doing? I said, not me. I want him to hold me, hug me, crush the bones, hug me hard. Because I know when he lets go, they're all going to be healed anyway. So, yeah, that's the type of hug I want. So, the father called out to his servants, quick, bring the best robe and put it on him. Put a ring on his finger and sandals on his feet. Bring the fattened calf and kill it. Let's have a celebration. For this son of mine was dead and is alive. Again, he was lost and is found. Was it saying that when one soul is saved, the angels in heaven celebrate? They celebrate. I remember when my daughter, Cameron, when they got baptized, when Landon got baptized, Austin and I got baptized at the same time. Those were joyous occasions. These are days I'll never forget. I'll never forget. But the celebration. Don't you just, when someone saves you, I just want to go up and hug them. I just want to hug them, hold on to them. But, you know, one thing I was going to mention a while ago, and I forgot to. Now, when he's talking about how he spent all of his money, I know for a fact from back in that old life. You lose all your money, guess how many friends you got left? None. Y'all know what I'm talking about, don't you? Yeah. You have no friends. You have nowhere to go because when that happened, you know, I wound up because of my choices, not because of God, not because of Shirley, my choices. I wound up sleeping either in the company van or underneath the company van. Because you know why? My pride. What's in the middle of pride? I got in my way. Just like this young man here, pride got in his way. Because I think I ought to, well, no, I can't, because I can't say, I know what I did, so I can't say that. I can't say what this parable would be if he did this. So, let's get into the older brother. I have issues with this, too. Thankfully, it's my younger brother back there. I didn't tell my older brother I was going to be on YouTube today, so hopefully he won't see it and come whoop me. Hey, Tony can still whoop me, what can I say? Meanwhile, the older brother was in the field. When he came near the house, he heard music and dancing. So he called one of the servants and asked him, what's going on? Your brother has come home, and your father has killed the fattened calf because he has him back safe and sound. I'm going to stop right there. This right here, when I truly accepted Jesus as my Lord and Savior, 22 years ago, people at work saw a difference in me. They're supposed to. But does it say, let he that is in me shine brightly today? And I had a lot of people waiting on me to fall. One instance, because I didn't have a license. I walked for 17 years. And I found out later on I didn't have to, but God knew better. God knew I didn't need a license. I needed to walk. Because I had to learn how to walk before I learned how to drive. But I went to go apply for my license. And I got shot down the first time. Everybody knew it right then. Oh, he's going back to drinking. He's going to do drugs. He's going to be lay out of work. I said, I never laid out of work before. Why should I lay out now? I mean, honestly, even doing all that time, I never laid out. I was there, but I really wasn't there. I fell asleep cooking one time. Try that one. But Said the older brother to accept his younger brother when he refused, returned, and it's just as difficult to accept younger brothers today. When Pastor Robert ordained me to be a minister, every member of my family was happy. I mean, my daughter, Awesome's going to be my hype man today, but he got here late. But my middle sister, Vivian, are my biggest supporters other than this body of Christ right here. And when you know you have that, I mean, like, ever since, you know, Tammy said, you know, you got the fifth Sunday in July. I said, oh, I do? She said, yes, you do. There was that mama look, mm-hmm. I said, okay. So I didn't worry about it. And last week, I was like, oh, what am I going to do? What am I going to do? First week, I was like, oh, what am I going to do? And I finally said, God, what do you want me to do? Led me to this. So when we just let God be God and let him work in us and through us, look at the things that can be done. And being envious, like I said, my older brother, I don't know why, but he would always preach down to me. And I can't stand that. One thing I always said, if I ever had the opportunity to be up on a pulpit like this, I would never look down on anyone. Because I've been in services where I thought they were. But having a family member do that, that's rough. People who repent after leading notorious lives. I led a notorious life. How about that? I just thought I was purity mean. Are often held in suspicion. Yeah, like I said, he ain't going to do it. He ain't going to make it. He was doing that so he could get his license, and I didn't get my license first time. Didn't change. I got upset, yeah. I should have had two better witnesses instead of captain of the fire department and, let's see, I can't remember. Larry, did you ever go with me? That's why I didn't get it. Larry was with me. No, actually, I'm thankful for the men who went. But, you know, it's like the Father, you know, he accepts us regardless. Like the father, this father and this, he said, he didn't care what his son, didn't even ask him, went running. If I don't see my children, now that son of mine who moved to Boonville, Arkansas, he did that just so I could, I don't know why he moved out there. Don't make no sense. But that one there, she'll tell you, if I don't speak to her in the week, I get upset. Yeah, okay. And those kids, especially that grandson of mine, who I love, that's right, shake that thing out of your eyes. I love every one of the people on that road and all these roads. But they hold a special place for me. They really do. That back there, oh well. Hey, see, I got a rule. If you're here, I won't talk about you, Austin. If you're not here, I'm going to run you down. But the older brother said, he became angry. He said, look, all these years I've been slaving for you and never disobeyed your orders, yet you never gave me any recognition, any acknowledgement. Well, you know, that has some bearings. When, like I said, I just, you know, have to talk about me. I ask God all the time. And Father, I said, you know, I've done this, you know, I'm doing this. Why? Why is this one who's not hardly doing nothing getting promoted, getting all that he wants? I said, I'm just getting by. He said, you're getting by. you're getting by. You know, I used to complain about my neuropathy in my feet. I've got a brother-in-law who might lose a foot if things don't go his way this week. You know, why is that old saying, I complained about my feet until I met a man with no feet? Who was I to complain? It says, my son, you're always with me, and everything I have is yours. But we had to celebrate and be glad because this brother of yours was dead and is alive again. In the story of the lost son, the father's response is contrasted with the older brothers. The father forgave because he was filled with love, like our Lord and Savior. The son refused to forgive because he was bitter about the injustice of it all. Yeah, there might have been some of that going around in my family. Because no matter what I did, God's always there. You know, even though I turned my back on God, God never turned his back on me. You know, there's a song out right now. I think I mentioned it Wednesday night. Can't remember who sings the song, but it says, the devil's trying to get me out of the church, but can't get the church out of me. Amen. Well, see, that's how it is with us. You know, Satan attacks us. I know all the way up until Robert said, and now. And, you know, I was going, oh, no, what am I going to do? And, you know, but I prayed for the Holy Spirit, you know, I said, Father God, just let your anointing come upon me and let your words flow off my lips. Because who am I? I'm a child of God. That's who I am. I'm a king. I'm a prince to the kingdom of God. It said the older brother represented the Pharisees, who were angry and resentful that sinners were being welcomed into God's kingdom. I'm glad we are. After all, the Pharisees must have thought, we have sacrificed and done so much for God. How easy it is to resent God's gracious forgiveness of others when we consider to be far worse sinners than ourselves. I've got a lot going on in my life right now. And, you know, I'm thankful. I drive for DoorDash. And they make me drive, all over the place. From here to Landis, other side of Fort, I go down past y'all's house, Tammy. Yeah, and you know what? I realize why I'm on these long roads and why God has me doing that right now. He and I have a lot of time to talk. Yeah, we have, oh my goodness. And the Holy Spirit will get me and say, no, you ain't supposed to say that when they cut in front of you. And I said, okay, forgive me, Father. I thank you for your forgiveness. I thank you for the Holy Spirit, not for condemnation, but for support. So our takeaway on this today, no matter what you've done, there is no such thing as a sin that's not forgivable. Because if it was, I'd have been dead years ago. It's on this wrist. I cut my wrist one night and commit suicide. Children don't know much of this one. And I was on St. Mary Street. And I cut it, and it's bleeding good. And I just laid down in a field to go to sleep. Next thing I know, I also remember old Robbie Troutman, fireman. I wake up and there's Robbie, one of the deacons from Emmanuel Baptist, with my hand, his bandaging up. And he said, Jack, he said, you ain't supposed to do this. Now, he could have took me to the hospital and there'd have been a lot of legal mess over that, but took me home. Went and got his personal car and took me home to Mama. Mama didn't say, why'd you do this? She said, well, come on, get on in here. Like God, come on, get on in here where you belong. That's what he's saying today. If you're here, or if you hear my voice, and you think you've gone too far, that you cannot turn around, well, guess what? When you turn around, bam, there he is. Remember, he said, I would never leave nor forsake you. He said, I'll be beside you through it all. And when you turn around, you know, when I turn around, there he was in my bedroom, that dirty old bedroom in that filthy house. The Holy Spirit of God came upon me. And have I slipped? Of course I have. This flesh is sin. My spirit, it's sealed by the Holy Spirit. Nothing I do or say will ever take that from me. You're the same way. If you don't know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior today, before you leave, I'd ask that you just make that commitment. You don't have to come down here in front of everybody. Get me, Pastor Howard, Pastor Reed. Anybody you see in one of these blue shirts, grab them. Be more than happy to talk with you. Or my mother, Tammy. Thank you.
You could about say, this is your life. We've all had, if you made Jesus, you have life. Before then, we were all lost. We're born into sin. We're born sinners. But I got news for you. You can get born again. That's what Jack's preaching. You don't have, and once you get born again, I want you to understand, if you've heard this and you've heard it wrong, hear it right. You are no longer a sinner if you get born again. In other words, God, when you truly repent and ask Jesus to be your Lord and Savior, he takes that old man and he kills him. And he gives you, and you become a new creature, a new creation that never existed before. You're born again. And it's like Jack said, we're going to stumble, we're going to fall, but that doesn't mean you're lost. You just need Christ. You need wisdom. You need a church. You need people to surround you that love you. He's the perfect one, and he's in you. And one day we're all going to be changed, but that doesn't mean we're not alone. You're not alone. Jack's made an appeal, and I want to share with you the word that this is a prayer and an appeal by the Apostle Paul, who ran his race, finished his course, and he is now in heaven, still teaching, still preaching, to all those that go. When we get to heaven, we're not done. We're just getting started about knowing God, knowing Jesus. In Ephesians 3, and this was written to the church, and Paul said, for this cause I bow my knees to the Father and Lord Jesus Christ, of whom the whole family in heaven and earth is named. Now, Paul's talking to the church. Once you get born again, your name changed. You're in the family. You're a child of God. You got a new name. It's no longer sin. It's righteousness. His righteousness. That means Jesus did it right when you did it wrong. Of whom the whole family in heaven and earth is named, that he would grant, Paul speaking, that he would grant you according to the riches of his glory. That's what's in store for you, right, Jack? That riches of his glory, to be strengthened with might by his Spirit, that's the Holy Spirit, in the inner man, that Christ may dwell in your hearts. That's what we're appealing, that Christ, he wants to dwell in your hearts by faith, that you got to be rooted and grounded in love, may be able to comprehend with all saints what is the breadth, what is the length, what is the depth, what is the height, and to know the love of Christ, it passes understanding. That you might be filled, this is God's purpose, this is his desire for us, that we might be filled with the fullness of God. Now unto him, now up until this point, I am teachable. I don't know it all, but I know the God who is all. And I'm in stages, we're all in stages. I got a little bit different revelation, when I say different than what I really kind of, I've got some light on this today. as I was reading it. Now, unto him that is able, now I was thinking about me right here, that through Christ, and I can do all things through Christ. But I'm seeing this is the Father. Because we're talking about the Father's love here that passes understanding. Now, unto him, oh, my Father, that is able to do exceedingly, abundantly, above all that you can even ask or think, according to the power, this is where we come in, that works in us. If you want to let the Father do exceedingly and bring all His promises to you, you got to let Him work. You got to let His power work in you. That doesn't mean you do the work. You let Him do the work, but you got to come and do what He says. His way. That's just being obedient. According to the power that works in us, unto Him, the Father. See, that's where I'm out of there. God gets all the glory in my life, in Jack's life, in your life. Unto Him be all glory in the church by Christ Jesus throughout all ages. Can I get an amen? That's God's appeal to you, and He uses ministers. He uses those that God has called me to minister. A minister is one that serves God by serving others. And we're here to serve you today. We have served you what God, His precious word, brings life. If you're in death, and death is not just physical, that's appointed to every man, but there is depression, there is suicidal thoughts, and that is the wages of sin that originated with the transgression, and the devil is the father of all sin. And when you get born again, your father changes to a father of light and love, and that is His desire for you. If you need that this morning, I don't want you to walk. I want you to run to this altar like I did 22 years ago. And not only will we be here, God will meet you here in your depression, in your loneliness, in your despair, in your sin. And He will remove it from you. And if you're born again, He will cleanse you and wash you. He has forgiven us. And I'm including me. I have been washed this morning by His presence, by His word. I have been ministered to because you are the church, not just me. And we're in this thing together. And we love you more. We love you more than the sin that would try to shackle you. And we're going to tell you the truth, that no matter what you've done, you're free. If you'll come to the one who set you free. This is His church. This is His altar. This is His glory. And if you need it today, you need to get down here right now. I said right now, come get Jesus. Come get his goodness this morning. You know who's coming first? I am. I'm coming. I'm not here to proclaim to you that I'm perfect, but I'm saved and I'm forgiven and I'm loved, and I need Him this morning. I need Him this morning. You need Him, you come. Come to this altar now. Now come. Lord, we need you this morning, Father. I bow my knee to you this morning, Father. To this world, to this church, to this people. And Father, we thank you, Lord, for your forgiveness this morning. I thank you, Lord, for your glory being displayed, not only now, but it will be displayed in Pastor Jack's life, Lord. That this day, Father God, is his day that he has proclaimed his presence, your presence in his life. And Lord, he will go back. He will go to the prisons, Lord, and he will bring that same testimony that he brought today. He'll bring it to those that are bound by sin, and he'll see them set free because the devil's a liar. And Father, all those that come today, all those that come to this church and come to this altar, Lord, we call them free today. Satan, we bind you in the name of Jesus. You have no right and you have no authority to those that bear the marks of a Christian. And we gladly pronounce today that you are defeated by the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. And we tell you to get underneath these people's feet. We break those shackles of sin right now. We take authority over all the wrong words that have been spoken and been received in their life, Lord. We counter them right now
in the name of Jesus, we call them free. When you come to this church, you come to a church that knows that God's people have been set free. And we declare that freedom today together, Father. And we thank you, Lord, that you're moving mightily in their lives right now, Lord. You're destroying those sins right now in Jesus' name. And you're restoring to them the joy, joy, joy of their salvation, which belongs to those that belongs to you, Christ, Jesus, the hope of glory. And Father, I thank you, Lord. I thank you, Lord, for calling me and sending me to this place to proclaim your glory to all those that will hear it, Lord. And you get it all. And we thank you for it today. I said we thank you for it today. Hallelujah. You're free.
Because Jesus set you free. You are free. Now go tell the world. Go set the world free. Amen. Don't lay down. Stand up for Jesus. Amen. Stand up for Jesus. Let's stand up for him. You need healing in your body? He's the healer. I said he's the healer. He's a mighty healer. I'm going to dismiss you. If you don't come back, I'm going to miss you. But if you need personal prayer, Jack told you that we're going to stay down here at this altar. Because if you feel like that you can't confess, I don't want you not confessing your faults to me. You're confessing them to God. I'm just somebody that you can see and that you can hug and that you can cry with. I'm the face of God through Jesus Christ, his son. I'm not the son, but we are a son. And we have sonship. And when the Father says, come home, he never kicks you out. We do that by choice. But he never. Jesus is the door. And this church has a door policy. It's called an open door policy. If it's only shut, it's because you shut it and you never came back. Because Jesus is always here. And he's in you. And he never leaves. But he will give you a choice to not listen. And won't obey. He won't make you do anything. But he loves you. Amen. So, Father, I thank you, Lord, I thank you for Pastor Jack. Lord, I thank you for his heart. Lord, he stood up here by faith and made a public declaration of what you have done in his life. And, Father, I thank you, Lord, for a mighty, mighty, mighty work, Lord. There's healing, Jack. There was healing manifesting in your body when you were up there standing for him. And you just keep your foot on the devil's neck. Because he has no right in your body, in your mind, in your future. Because you are where you're supposed to be. And you will decree and declare who you are. And the devil's a liar. That's all you got to let him know. You're a liar. And God, you're on fire for God. Amen. And God needs us. That means you're going to live a long, satisfied, prosperous life. That prosperous includes finances. In Jesus' name. Amen. 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 Hallelujah. You got it. You got it. You got it. Hallelujah. So, Father, we thank you, Lord. I thank you for the rich word that came forth this morning. And, Father, I thank you, Lord, for the power that's in the name of Jesus. And I call your people full of power and blessings today, Lord. Surely, that's one of your names y'all need to know. Surely, goodness and mercy is following you. Turn around and let God hug you with it. Quit letting him chase you and just turn around and let him really just embrace you. That's what he wants. In Jesus' name. Hug somebody, love somebody.
Thank you for joining us today at Word of Faith Worship Center. I pray God's grace and peace be multiplied unto you through the knowledge of God and of our Lord Jesus Christ. And if you do not know Jesus as your Lord and Savior, then according to Romans 10, 8 through 10, the word is nigh unto thee, in your mouth and in your heart. That is the word of faith which we preach. That if you will confess with your mouth Jesus as your Lord and believe that God has raised him from the dead, you shall be saved. For with the heart you believe unto righteousness, and with your mouth confession is made unto salvation. We would ask you today to simply say, yes, I believe this, and I say yes to Jesus. Now, if you just received Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, we would encourage you to get into a good church. Our church is located at 757 Harris Street, Northwest, Concord, North Carolina, 28025. And you can also find us on the internet at wordoffaithworshipcenter.org or wofwc.org. We hope to see you soon. Blessings.